Good afternoon. I'm Ben Fix, Deputy Chief Financial Officer at the US NRC. I'm very happy to welcome you to this virtual RIC session on Be Risk Smart, Real Examples, Real Impact. I have the honor to serve as the chair of this panel. As one of the three original executive sponsors for the Be Risk Smart initiative, representing the corporate perspective, it's wonderful for me to see the significant amount of progress we've made over the last 2 years. We've developed the Be Risk Smart framework and issued guidance last March that is publicly available. We also developed Be Risk Smart training for NRC staff, which over half of the NRC staff have completed. We also have numerous success stories around across the agency of staff applying the Be Risk Smart framework, and we're excited to share some of those with you today. Please submit your questions as we go along, and we will answer as many as possible after our panelists' presentations. We'll be asking you two poll questions, so as they pop up, please answer those and we can share the results as we have them with you. Please click on the word poll on the right side of the screen. And we actually have our first question, which is, have you heard about the NRC's Be Risk Smart framework for decision making? We'll give you a moment to answer that question, and then we'll share the results. So I think it just takes a second here for it to come up. So thank you for your patience. So it looks like 63% of you have heard about the NRC's Be Risk Smart framework, and about 39% no. All right, well, that helps us as we go into our panel, so I appreciate that. So slide two. Just take a second for that to come up. Okay, so we have a wonderful panel assembled of NRC staff members. Reed Anzalone will describe the Be Risk Smart framework and share reactor examples. Mr. Anzalone is a data scientist for the Embark Venture Studio in the NRC's Office of Nuclear Reactor Regulation. He's the product manager for the NRC's Mission Analytics Portal, a suite of data analytics tools designed to facilitate access to data and enhance data-driven decision-making at the NRC. He's also a member of the Be Risk Smart core team. Mr. Anzalone holds a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from the Virginia Tech University and also a master's degree in mechanical engineering from the University of Texas at Austin. He's recently gotten into 3D printing and is known for having a dry sense of humor. We also have Mirabelle Shoemaker, international safeguards analyst in our Office of Nuclear Materials Safety and Safeguards, who will be sharing materials program examples. Ms. Shoemaker began supporting the agency's Be Risk Smart team in 2020 due to her curiosity about how to apply the framework to her niche area of international safeguards and material control and accounting for special nuclear material. She's become a Be Risk Smart ambassador for NMSS, supporting multiple working groups as they apply the framework to activities across the NMSS business lines. She's a notorious houseplant killer, but is a proud parent to three thriving children, ages 6, 3, and 1. She has a dual BA, BS from George Washington University in International Affairs and Political Science, and she has an MA in International Affairs from Catholic University. We also have Billy Dixon, Branch Chief in Region 3. He will be sharing inspection examples. Mr. Dixon joined the NRC in 1996. He started his NRC career as a reactor engineer in Region 3, and he's held positions as a resident inspector at Dresden, senior resident at both Clinton Power Station and Braidwood Nuclear Station, and branch chief of the Physics, Health Physics and Incident Response Branch in the Division of Reactor Safety in Region 3. Mr. Dixon received a BS degree in nuclear engineering from Mississippi State University, and he loves fishing. Rounding out our panel is Stacy Prasad, Security Risk Analyst, Nuclear Security and Incident Response, who will be sharing security examples. Ms. Prasad was technically trained as a computer and electrical engineer at Drexel University before beginning her career at the NRC in 2003. She's worked in the regional office supporting the resident inspector program and regional inspections before moving to NRC headquarters to support electrical inspections for vendors supplying components to operating reactors, aircraft impact inspections, and implementations of NRC's enforcement program. And in NSER, she became one of the ambassadors for the riskSMART initiative. Stacy indicated that she's using the 3 extra hours a day that she has saved by not commuting during the pandemic by picking up the violin again. Her husband is grateful to the riskSMART framework as he was able to utilize the framework to promote a different, quieter alternative to practicing a musical instrument by determining the risk to his hearing was not justified. At this point, I'll turn it over to Reed.
Thanks, Ben. So if we can go to the next slide. So I'll be walking you all through the riskSMART framework. And before I get started with that, I want to acknowledge that riskSMART is kind of a cutesy name, but you shouldn't be fooled by that. It's a robust framework for integrated risk-informed decision-making. So next, please. The first step is to be clear about the problem. This step frames the scope of what you're trying to address, which helps you a lot down the line as you begin to identify risks and how to manage them. And we actually found that without this step, it's really difficult to make sure you're appropriately constraining the scope of the decision that you're trying to make. Next. Then you spot what can go wrong or right, what are the consequences and how likely is it? And for those of you who might be familiar with probabilistic risk assessment, this is essentially just identifying elements of the risk triplet. Risk is likelihood times consequences with a couple of minor differences from how we normally do it. The first is that we want to explicitly consider benefits in the decision because those are an important factor. And as we worked through the framework, we found oftentimes that it was easier to consider consequences before probability, but that's not a hard and fast rule. Next, please. Then you manage what you can. This step gives you a space to think about the risks and benefits that you can affect and how you would manage them to attenuate the risks and accentuate the benefits. Next. The next step is to act on a decision. Once you've got all the risks and management strategies figured out, you make a decision while considering your risk appetite for this particular decision. And that can vary depending on the kind of decision that you're trying to make. If it's a decision that's just for you, it might be your own personal risk appetite. If it's a decision for your organization, you might need to factor in your organizational risk appetite. Next. The next step is to realize the result. And this seems to kind of trip some people up, but really it's just the step where you take the decision that you've made and you go forth and implement it. And then while you do that, you manage what you need to make the risks acceptable or the benefits more appealing, and you monitor your performance and progress as you go through. Next. The next step is to teach others what you learned. And this step is really important for us at the NRC to create a record of our decision, but it's also really important for knowledge management and to help spread the word of how riskSMART helped in the decision-making process. And finally, next. So at the bottom of our logo, there is a little arrow underneath, and that emphasizes the iterative nature of the process. As you make one decision, you may need to roll right into the next one, or in some cases, if the conditions that went into your riskSMART evaluation changed, you might want to take another look at it. So that's the process. And now I'm going to go through some examples from the reactor area. So next slide, please. So the first impact that I'm going to talk about for that riskSMART is helping have in our in the reactor area is making decisions in the presence of uncertainty. So the riskSMART helps you identify and monitor conditions that are uncertain so you can manage them appropriately before they become an issue, particularly using the manage what you can and realize the result steps of the framework. And in general, having a structured framework like riskSMART, it helps give you confidence that you're adequately considering what you need to, even when there's a lot of uncertainty about what could happen or how likely it is. So the first example I'm gonna talk to on this slide is the Vogel 10 CFR 52.103G finding. So for those of you who might not be aware, Vogtle Units 3 and 4 are Westinghouse AP1000 reactors that are under construction in Georgia. And these plants can't officially operate until the NRC makes a finding under 10 CFR 52.103G that all the acceptance criteria have been met. And there are a lot of inspections, tests, analyses, and acceptance criteria leading up to that finding. This means there are a wide variety of scenarios that might occur in the late stages of the construction process that could delay an otherwise timely regulatory finding if we're not prepared for them. The staff used the BRISK-SMART framework to identify all the possible risks and outcomes and put in place plans to manage those risks where necessary. This has included training, tabletop exercises, and a new office instruction to provide support to the staff. And one element that we put in place is shown on the screen, and that's a dashboard to help us track completion of activities related to Vogtle 3 and 4. And while we haven't made a finding under 52.103G yet, we have confidence that we'll be able to handle whatever comes our way because we've thought it through. Another example of how BRISK-SMART helps us make decisions in the presence of uncertainty is related to a CRDM funnel issue that happened at a pressurized water reactor. So during a refueling outage, there was a pressurized water reactor licensee that identified that a CRDM funnel had detached, control run drive mechanism, sorry. And the NRC had to figure out the safety significance of this issue and what level of oversight was appropriate as the licensee worked to repair the problem. Now, a lot could potentially go wrong if the control rods don't work correctly, but the NRC staff evaluated the issue using the BRISK-SMART framework and found that the risk that the control rods weren't inserted correctly was managed appropriately during startup with multiple tests. Risks of foreign material associated with the funnel repair were managed through the licensee's foreign material exclusion program. The NRC inspectors at the site decided to focus on the foreign material exclusion program and only nominally inspect the other aspects of the event because they were routine at the site. There were no issues at startup, and we were able to minimize the use of NRC resources and focus on only the most safety significant issues. And one final example for this slide is related to Regulatory Guide 1.99, which provides a model for radiation embrittlement of reactor vessels. So there are some indications that this model may be non-conservative relative to actual test data at high neutron fluences that would occur at extended plant lifetimes, but the data is limited because we don't have a lot of operating experience in that regime. A model that's been developed by the international community appears like it represents the high fluence data better than RIC Guide 1.99, but again, the data is limited. Staff considered all possible outcomes that could result from a non-conservative RIC Guide 1.99 model, and staff also did a probabilistic fracture mechanics evaluation that found the risk of brittle failure to be low, even if the model is non-conservative. They factored this into a BRISK-SMART evaluation that included all of these considerations and found that the model was adequate for now, but we're going to continue monitoring material samples collected under 10 CFR Appendix H and operating experience related to pressure vessel embrittlement to ensure that the model continues to be adequate. All right, next slide. So the second impact is making use of all available evidence to make a decision. And this has been alluded to a couple of times in different plenary sessions. I know the commissioner, the chairman is very keyed into making sure that we are using data and evidence needed to make decisions. And BRISK-SMART is one way that we can help bring all of the available information to bear, including risks, into our decision. So the example I'm going to talk about on this slide is about operator licensing for Vogtle Unit 4. As I mentioned, that's one of the units that's under construction down in Georgia. Now, typically for licensed operators, comparable units are added to the operator's license using the waiver process under 10 CFR 55.47 to avoid the need for additional examination. However, this waiver requires the operator to have extensive experience on the original unit, and for operators licensed at Vogtle 3, the waiver process for Vogtle 4 is complicated by the fact that Vogtle 3 is still under construction. The staff evaluated this issue using BRISK-SMART and found that there were both legal and enterprise risks with attempting to use the waiver provision in spite of these challenges. However, the staff also didn't think it would be necessary or efficient to have the licensed operators take another exam for Vogtle Unit 4. So what to do? Using the risks and benefits uncovered by BRISK-SMART, Staff decided that exemptions would be both more appropriate and more legally defensible than using waivers. Staff also decided that in the long term, rulemaking is needed to address this issue going forward for other multi-unit sites under construction. Now I'm going to turn it over to Mirabel to talk about some examples from the materials area.
Thanks, Reid. So something I've experienced firsthand when using the BRISKSMART framework is discovering access to the greater toolbox for risk assessment and risk management and decision-making. Being able to identify the entire applicable toolbox for risk-informed decision-making is especially important in an office like NMSS, which works across multiple business lines and disciplines. And it's also incredibly valuable for decision-making that considers qualitative information. Whether I've worked in a matrix team or within my own working unit, BRISKSMART has enabled our team to identify the guidance and tools that will aid in decision-making at all levels. So as the first bullet states, in using BRISKSMART, staff doesn't need to reinvent the wheel. Instead, the framework provides a common approach to identify and assess risk across various disciplines. A good example of this is when NMSS was faced with two activities, a rulemaking discontinuation and a pilot program for graded approach. Staff faced the question of whether they could discontinue the rulemaking before completing the pilot and determining it was successful. So this became the problem statement for both working groups. And by using the framework in parallel, the staff identified that there could be risks related to public confidence and effective regulation if the activities were not sequenced appropriately. So using the BRISKSMART framework, the staff spotted these risks and identified what could go right or wrong for both rulemaking and licensing activities. And in using this common approach to spot, manage, and then act on risk insights, staff determined that publishing the rulemaking discontinuation before completing the pilot would likely produce concerns of public perception that the pilot was not fully considered before the rulemaking discontinuation. So staff assessed that waiting to publish the rulemaking after the pilot would allow the pilot to reach a level of maturity that would give enough information to demonstrate a risk-informed approach and uphold principles of good regulation. So in this example, we sequenced both packages for concurrence. When the pilot on the graded approach was confirmed with no significant adverse comments received, the rulemaking discontinuation package could reference the completion of the pilot. So in this example, two groups responsible for different disciplines were able to identify and manage risks by coordinating their efforts through BRISKSMART. Now there are times where disciplines converge and a matrix team is needed to support NMSS activities. Contracting renewals, for example, require coordination with corporate and technical staff before we can renew a contract. In these cases where matrix teams are assembled, team members come to the table focused on their expertise areas, equipped with the tools that allow them to identify and assess risk. So as the second bullet states, BRISKSMART is beneficial to matrix teams because when the team has access to the full toolbox for risk-informed decision-making, they can have a coordinated and systematic approach when considering multiple risk factors with varying uncertainties. So consider a licensing for a fuel facility. The team reviewing the application includes safety and security experts, environmental technical reviewers, legal staff, and of course, management. Now the BRISKSMART framework supports a collaborative approach to identifying the problem statement and spotting risk and balancing those considerations in multiple risk areas. During a recent license renewal for a fuel facility, staff conducted the environmental review in accordance with the NEPA requirements. They published a draft environmental assessment and a finding of no significant impact for public review and comment. And during the comment period, new information arose and produced public concern over groundwater contamination and other potential hazards in the area. So staff swiftly applied the framework to the problem statement. How does this new information affect the current environmental assessment and the finding of no significant impact? And should the NRC change its review to an environmental impact statement, considering this new information? So by using the framework, the staff balanced risks related to safety and public perception. And in this example, they took a more conservative approach by proceeding with an environmental impact statement. And this was the first time an environmental review for a fuel facility resulted in not in an EA FONSI decision. So management was incorporated in the consideration well in advance through the use of the BRISC-SMART framework. It was critical for communicating the staff's risk assessment and management plan and to avoid significant delays to the project schedule by commencing the EIS as soon as possible. So to summarize the key messages on the slide, the BRISC-SMART framework serves like an umbrella. It houses all the available risk tools under it. One division in NMSS developed an infographic that I included on this slide, and it articulates the steps of decision-making, highlighting BRISC-SMART at the beginning. The elements of BRISC-SMART are conducive for early and comprehensive identification of risk and a coordinated application of quantitative or qualitative risk assessment tools. And the goal is communicating the decision, achieving alignment, and acting on that decision. Next slide. Now, I alluded to a benefit of using BRISC-SMART, and I want to dive into that a little bit more with examples on this slide. So using BRISC-SMART, staff is able to achieve early alignment on risks with decision makers. Specifically, early alignment on potential risks allow the NRC to develop a management plan in environmental reviews. I mentioned a license renewal for a fuel facility a moment ago, where alignment and action was needed before staff could proceed with an environmental impact statement. Early alignment enables earlier action, whether that's allocating resources or developing a communication plan, and earlier action can reduce impacts to the project timeline. So let me highlight another example. The BRISC-SMART approach has been used pretty faithfully in environmental reviews within NMSS, especially when issues involve public stakeholder engagement. So BRISC-SMART allows staff to incorporate public perception risks alongside safety and security issues. And a recent example is when BRISC-SMART was applied when considering whether the environmental impact statement comment period should be extended based on public request. So in accordance with NEPA, NMSS prepared an EIS, and the typical comment period lasts about 45 to 60 days. Public stakeholders can submit requests to extend the public comment period, and there's no limit on the number of requests that may be submitted or the length of time for the extension. BRISC-SMART has been helpful in guiding these environmental teams through consideration of these requests. The framework gives weight to the value of public participation in environmental reviews. In the spotting and managing steps, teams will consider potential risks if public participation is not maximized or doubt arises in public confidence. Using BRISC-SMART, the staff has been able to efficiently disposition requests for public comment period extensions to minimize impacts to project timelines while supporting full public participation. We also saw the benefits of early alignment very beneficial with the onset of the COVID-19 public health emergency. Identifying risks early allowed the NRC to focus on risk significance during a time when we were in mandatory telework. I'd like to highlight a specific example before turning it to my colleague, Billy, who will give another example of BRISC-SMART during COVID-19. So during the public health emergency, when we were in mandatory telework, like the rest of the government, we were faced with a challenge in continuing on-site inspections at facilities. Specifically, we had planned for an on-site inspection at an independent spent fuel storage installation site. And the purpose of the inspection was to observe the spent fuel loading campaign. ISPC inspections of this nature are conducted every 2 years, and this particular site was due for completion in 2021. So postponing would result in a missed opportunity to evaluate cask loading, which is the most risk significant activity at an ISPC. Understandably, this problem was of interest across management and office levels. It was a prime opportunity to deploy BRISC-SMART and gain alignment early, especially with the small window of opportunity to observe a cask loading. So following the elements of BRISC-SMART, the staff identified and weighed the risks of what could go right or wrong in conducting this inspection, and then the likelihood, and then the balancing those considerations of safety in the traditional sense of ISPC operation, as well as the public health and safety considerations in the pandemic. The decision makers agreed with the recommendation for remote inspection with support from the licensee cameras and remote monitoring to allow us to observe cask loading in real time. A direct line of communication was maintained with the site, and remote administrative reviews facilitated observing the loading campaign. And the result that was realized was early alignment enabled efficiency in decision-making during a narrow window of opportunity. It also produced a secondary benefit of developing innovative solutions to deploy remote monitoring, which resulted in longer observations of multiple simultaneously occurring activities. with reduced accumulated dose to the inspectors. My colleague in the region has personal experience using BRiskSMART during COVID-19. So thank you for your time. And Billy, I look forward to hearing your example next.
Thank you. So use of the BRiskSMART process has allowed regional organizations to identify, evaluate, and treat risks to different degrees of formality. In some cases, it's helped to limit the scope of problems to individual branches, divisions, or facilities. In others, it's helped expand solutions to the enterprise level. It's provided means for evaluating, assessing, and managing risk, whether it's regulatory risk, operational risk, or reputational risk, in areas where traditional standards have been established, but don't explicitly address these types of risk. One of the more significant impacts of the use of the BRiskSMART process allowed for the adaptation and use of new and existing technology, specifically during the onset and prior to the declaration of a national health emergency, when there were several unknowns and uncertainties. It was essential that the inspection staff was protected against this threat while maintaining the agency's essential need to have situational awareness. The BRiskSMART methodology was used to evaluate the feasibility of using licensee provided computer and equipment offsite to substitute for the presence of the resident inspector staff for specific inspection activities. The BRiskSMART process was also used at the inspection program implementation level to find acceptable methods to perform key ROP inspections, such as the baseline, such as the problem identification and resolution inspection, and the cybersecurity inspections remotely or partly remotely. This process has resulted in organizations being more strategic about how to manage and deal with the unexpected, resulting in a more agile organization. Next slide, please. So regional organizations utilize the BRiskSMART process to provide for greater flexibility and the ability to adapt to changing conditions when faced with certain decisions within well-defined processes. For example, in one of the regional offices, a decision had been made to commence a special inspection to assess a series of failures of the diesel generator at a site. During the preparation for the start of this special inspection, what was described as a complicated reactor trip occurred at that site. When evaluated using the Management Directive 8.3 process, the event landed in the overlap region between the baseline inspection and conducting a special inspection. The BRiskSMART process was used to assess a range of options related to the region's follow-up response to this event. Ultimately, through options derived during the use of the spot phase of the BRiskSMART methodology, the regions decided to combine both the diesel generator issues along with issues observed during the complicated reactor trip into a single special inspection. The exercise of answering the questions of what could go right or wrong, or what are the consequences, help inform decisions such as the team composition and communications with the licensee and the public. It also helped develop guideposts and warning signs for regional management related to when that decision to combine the special inspection needed to be reassessed. In another example, the BRiskSMART process was used to evaluate a suggestion from the Region 3 risk-informed decision-making team to assign a dedicated inspector strictly to evaluate the licensee's management of risk during outages. So refueling outages are part of the baseline inspection program, and the inspection procedure contains a variety of inspection requirements. Depending on what activities are planned during the refueling outage, not all of the inspection requirements are equal risk importance, and some, such as the containment walkdowns, require inspector attention regardless of other ongoing outage activities. Over the years, outage durations have significantly decreased, making it challenging for the resident inspectors to complete the inspection requirements while focusing on the most safety significant issues. According to resident inspectors when the outage schedules change, the sequencing and risk assessment of activities and the related contingencies can consume a great amount of time and inspector focus. The regions have supplemented the resident inspectors with other inspectors during refueling outages, but the resources were not always specifically focused on assessment and management of outage risk during periods of elevated risk. The challenge is to complete the inspection, use risk insights to focus the additional inspectors assigned, and it remained within the inspection baseline sample, procedure samples in estimated hours. Using the BRIS-SMART process, Region 3 implemented the practice of supplementing the res inspectors doing carefully selected refuel outages with staff that specifically focus on licensees assessment and management of outage risk during periods of elevated risk. By having the dedicated inspectors, those activities were able to be assessed at a level commensurate with risk rather than the availability of the res inspector staff. The dedicated inspector position permitted the res inspector staff to remain aware of all outage activities and the associated risk, while the dedicated inspector was able to closely inspect specific activities and associated contingencies based on their detailed review of the licensee shutdown plan. To support the realize and teach phase of the BRIS-SMART process, the dedicated inspector provided the coordinator of this effort with notes regarding lessons learned associated with implementing this activities. These lessons learned were summarized and have been shared with the regional inspection staff during knowledge management sessions, and the regional staff has provided feedback to the inspection program office and NRR regarding ways to risk rank or prioritize this specific inspection procedure requirements within the refueling outage inspection procedure. I believe that this effort will help improve the effectiveness of the baseline inspection process and program. In summary, during my participation applying some of these examples discussed today and my studying of other examples from other regions, I have concluded that the BRIS-SMART process has served as a source of improved risk communications. At each phase of the BRIS-SMART methodology, the impact of uncertainties from all the types of risk must be discussed, evaluated, and managed. And in my opinion, the BRIS-SMART process has helped advance the ideal that risk communications are not just a separate component of a specific process, such as the ROP significance determination process. I've concluded that the BRIS-SMART process must be integrated in all aspects of decision-making, both at all levels, both informally and formally. So next, Stacy will discuss other examples where the BRIS-SMART methodology was used to further refine other processes. Stacy?
Thanks, Billy. Processes are the way the public knows they can trust us when we make safety decisions, as highlighted by the chairman during a speech that kicked off the RIC this year. So lucky you, you're going to get a couple more slides on how the framework was used on NRC processes. In the first case of the three cases on this slide, we used BRIS-SMART to take a look at the process to issue national special security event-related security advisories. It's mouthful. The purpose of these advisories is to communicate urgent, time-sensitive, operational information that directly relates to the security and common defense of national infrastructure. They're operational in nature and are issued in response to urgent situations or recently identified vulnerabilities. Using the framework helped identify a way to remove review timelines when previously approved boilerplate language is used. So this basically means we're now able to expedite issuance without compromising the review process. This example provides a good reminder that just because a process has worked in the past, it does not mean it can't be challenged and that the BRIS-SMART tools cannot be used to identify ways to further risk-inform processes. The second example focuses on an inspection procedure process. While revising the procedure staff used to perform cybersecurity inspections, staff utilized the BRIS-SMART framework to determine whether performance metrics submitted by licensees could be used to perform cybersecurity inspections more efficiently. In this case, there was a particular direction in mind from the staff in the headquarters office for how the procedures should be updated, but working through the process included communication with regional offices that helped identify additional what can go right, what can go wrong criteria that were not initially identified. So this helped to further risk-informed updates and ultimately change the procedure a little bit. The headquarters staff learned that early engagement is beneficial for procedural development processes. In the last example on this slide, it discusses the current process the NRC uses to provide alerts and warnings for geomagnetic disturbances. Staff used the framework to determine if alerts or warnings should also be provided for possible or future events, kind of like a pre-notification. So this was evaluated and it was determined that the process should remain as is since there were no safety consequences related to not making these pre-notifications. This last example is particularly important to show that the framework is being used by staff to ask questions, to identify what can go right and wrong, assess a consequence, and make an informed decision that does not necessarily always result in a change. Next slide. All right, switching gears a little, kind of going back to the public health emergency. As the COVID public health emergency was first emerging, the agency had to make some tough decisions on how to best implement our inspection program while considering both the safety of those being inspected and the staff going out to perform those inspections. One of the security inspections we perform are the force-on-force inspections, and they verify effective implementation of a licensee physical protection program. These inspections involve a significant amount of people that can be in close proximity in order to properly control, observe, and perform the inspection. These are very large inspections compared to most other NRC inspections. Before deciding on the best way to conduct these inspections, the NRC assessed multiple options, assessed the risks of each option using the BureauSmart framework before we made a final decision on how to best and most importantly, safely perform the inspection. For this example, we created a matrix where we weighed principles of good regulation to inform our decision. So we've been able to reuse this matrix to help us inform our decisions in the areas of efficiency, openness, clarity, reliability, and independence. In this case, using the framework helps staff identify other options that, although not the best option during the public health emergency, can be used and considered to better inform the future of our security program. Continuing with the theme of how the framework is being used to inform decisions during COVID, the NRC identified the risk of the impact to delayed billing for applicants and licensees during the public health emergency and its potential impact on NRC meeting our statutory collection requirements. The public health emergency caused financial impacts to NRC licensees, disrupting their operations and challenging their ability to pay NRC fees. Using the framework, a decision was made to suspend billing of fees for a 90-day period in 2020. The deferral mitigated the risk of significant unpaid invoices. The action of deferring payment to mitigate the financial impact illustrated that the NRC can be flexible while continuing to comply with statutory requirements. Now I'll hand it over to Ben to give you guys a little break from all the process talk. Ben?
Thank you, Stacy. Just to remind everybody, please feel free to put in your questions at any time in the chat box in the right-hand side. We're happy to answer your questions after we get through our presentation. So I would like to share a corporate example now related to advancing strategic workforce planning. I am choosing this example as I know we're not unique at NRC with this challenge and that many of you may be likely experiencing similar challenges with an uptick in retirements in your organizations. Our Office of the Chief Human Capital Officer applied the riskSMART framework to the NRC Summer Hire Program to mitigate the risk of missing the best candidates by making selections too late in the year. After analyzing using the riskSMART framework, they decided to shift their recruitment to start earlier and to use a tiger team approach of supervisors across NRC to speed the process and to foster greater collaboration. Those changes have improved the timeliness, quality, and diversity of that important entry-level feeder pool for the agency. Our Office of Research was able to leverage that summer hire program along with other hiring innovations in FY 2021 to fully utilize their staffing levels going into FY 22. Specifically, they applied the BRISKSMART framework to address this risk and implemented proactive strategies, including aggressive use of summer hires and conversions of those summer hires to co-op positions, external hiring at lower grades in critical skill areas, including strategic overhires, and they leveraged the university grants list. This chart shows the staffing utilization over 3 years. The agency is in orange and research is in blue. You can see that the Office of Research achieved 100% utilization going into FY22. The lessons they learned will be very important as the agency works to address this enterprise risk this year across all offices, consistent with the EDO's vision. Next slide. I'm going to pause for a second and ask you to complete our next poll. So again, on the right-hand side, please click poll and you should see a question, have you seen impacts from NRC using BRISKSMART? So I will take a moment to let you fill that out and we will share the results. Okay. So it looks like the data is starting to stabilize. Thank you very much for your feedback. We have about 43% of you guys saying that I have not seen any impacts. We've seen 34% where you've seen impacts and they specifically impacted you. And yes, you've seen impacts, 22%, but they haven't specifically impacted you. All right, well, that's very helpful. We appreciate the feedback as we continue to improve the rollout of the BRiskSMART throughout the agency. So going back to my slide. So I just wanted to conclude by saying that these examples demonstrate that we shared with you the impact that we've had so far of applying BRiskSMART across all parts of NRC, programmatic, legal, and corporate. And as highlighted by the panel, the application of BRiskSMART has had multiple impacts, including improving confidence in making decisions in the face of uncertainties, helping to achieve early identification and alignment on potential risks, enhancing decision-making and risk communications in the region, helping staff assess and select the best option, and also advancing strategic workforce planning. On this list, we have a series of resources for you to use if you're interested off the NRC homepage. You just click on transformation on the left-hand side of NRC's homepage and then click on risk, and you'll see the BRiskSMART guidance, training video on BRiskSMART, more case studies, and also a link to our transformation survey for NRC's external stakeholders that includes the risk-informed decision-making questions. We'd like to acknowledge Morella Gavrilis, PhD and Director of the Office of Nuclear Security and Incident Response, for doing an amazing job leading the BRiskSMART team. And now we're going to turn it to questions. So to get the panel started, we wanted to ask the question whether or not you've seen BRiskSMART make a difference, if you have any data to support whether or not you believe that it has. So Reid, I wanted to start off with you, and then I can share some information as well.
Sure. So internally, we have data from some polling that we've done for the staff, showing a noticeable positive shift in attitudes toward risk-informed decision-making over the last few years. We've also conducted surveys as part of BRiskSMART to better understand who's driving risk-informed decision-making at the NRC. And most of the staff that we've polled think that management and individual contributors are about equally involved in driving forward risk-informed decision-making. So we think that that's been at least partially a result of the implementation of BRiskSMART. And I would say sort of more anecdotally, we're having more conversations about risk and how to manage risk. And I would say also, in large part, thanks to the pandemic, people are starting to have more conversations about, you know, what risks there are and how to manage them. And I think BRiskSMART has given staff a common sense framework to think about risks as these conversations are occurring. That's just for internal. And you wanted to tackle external, Ben?
Yeah, unless any other panel members wanted to add to what Reid had said before I do that. Okay, so we do have a goal of at least 75% of our external stakeholders that we're currently surveying in this year agreeing to the fact that risk information and data has improved the timeliness and quality of agency decision making. And while we don't have a lot of people responding right yet, we're still collecting data. The ones who have responded so far, 50% of the respondents agree that the use of risk information has improved the quality of decision-making over the past year, and that 41% agree that the use of risk information and data has improved the timeliness of decision-making. So I do think that we are making progress, but there's more work to be done. And I think that somewhat correlates with what we were seeing internally, Reid, that you were sharing. Okay, so let's see. I think we have another question here. This one is to Reid and to Billy. Is BRISC-SMART or risk-informed decision-making at the point where we're able to say PRAs are worth it?
I can go first. Okay. You know, there are a lot of licensees who have NRC reviewed PRAs. I want to say it's probably around half of them. And BRISC-SMART is one of the tools that we have that can incorporate that into our decision-making process. There are other ones like the risk-informed process for evaluations or the very low safety significance issue resolution effort. Lots of other risk-informed decision-making processes that are all, I would say, more or less consistent with BRISC-SMART. As to whether they're worth it or not, I think that is something that individual licensees will have to figure out for themselves. But, you know, we are trying to do more to be able to take advantage of that. Those insights that we get from PRAs and other risk analysis tools and incorporate those better into our decision-making processes, because we think that that's important data that we can use to make better decisions and make sure that we're focusing on the most significant things.
Thank you, Reed. And from my perspective as a manager of the inspection group, I believe that the PRA is worth it. I mean, it allows our inspectors to focus on the issues that matter. When we're doing an assessment of issues, the PRA results help us key in on those risk important issues that we need to key in on to be an effective regulator. So yes, I do believe the PRAs are worth it.
All right, we have another question. This is to Reed, and I think Mirabelle, you said that you would be able to add in after Reed answers as well. What role does considering benefit play in your BRISC-SMART decision making?
So I think that benefits are there to make sure that you are, when we were originally coming up with the framework, we wanted to make sure that you would acknowledge that there might be a benefit that you would miss out on if you chose a decision one way versus the other. So for instance, let me think of a good example. If you decided to do something, tackle a problem one way, there might be a benefit that you would miss out on that could be gained from another way of approaching it. So that was one of the reasons we wanted to include benefits. Also, we wanted to make sure that we were really factoring in all of the available information. You know, benefits and risks kind of go hand in hand. I guess that's what I would say to that.
Yeah, Reed, I think you touched on what I wanted to highlight about benefits is that when you look at the risk triplet, there's the opportunity to consider what can go wrong and what can go right. And what can go right is an opportunity. There's a yielded benefit potentially from one decision making to another. I think I highlighted in the example of the COVID-19 public health emergency when we were considering whether or not to conduct inspections remotely. We came up with our decision to do a remote monitoring, and there was the added benefit in another area to be able to use technology, observe the inspection in multiple ways, simultaneous activities that were occurring at the same time. And we actually ended up with, I would say, a greater risk-informed decision. So benefit in the early stages of spotting what can go right and identifying an opportunity allows you to make a comprehensive risk-informed decision.
So we have another question. I think this is for Mirabelle and Stacy. Is the agency thinking about extending the very low safety significance issue resolution process to other business lines and activities?
I'll take the question first. So with respect to very low safety significance issue resolution, NMSS has created a working group. One was set up in 2020 to consider whether we could apply NRR's V-Lister concept in NMSS. And actually the working group created a digital exhibit that's available at this RIC. In addition to this digital exhibit, which provides additional information and resources you can look to online, the working group created screening guidance to be incorporated in the technical assistance review process to aid staff in identifying issues that might be candidates for the application of V-Lister. The working group is mostly working with supporting staff that it's in the process of updating inspection manual chapters to see how V-Lister principles can be consistently incorporated into these revisions of the chapters. The working group is also supporting engagement with industry. Recently, a topic on the issue of short-term operations at ISPCs was identified by general license holders as maybe a potentially appropriate topic. V-Lister principles have been pulled in to those public meetings for consideration. It's something that's currently underway, so I can't speak to it too much, but we're soliciting from industry, you know, potential topics where V-Lister can be applied. The working group will be looking to create a public-facing webpage after the RIC to be able to provide updates on the application of V-Lister on fuel cycle decommissioning and ISPCs and material users. So we welcome that kind of feedback after the RIC.
I'll just add a little bit for security here. So V-Lister is part of the process we use when we determine how to process an issue of concern, and that includes security concerns. So when any region comes to us and they have a security issue, we have a security forum where input is received from all staffs and regions, kind of like a little panel to get everyone's opinion, make sure we're being consistent with the application of our regulations. And in this, we include assessing the significance of security performance deficiencies. So we have been using, I think it came out in 2019, and we're beginning to see staff question it more and more as time goes on.
All right, so we have another question for the entire panel. How do you consider multiple risks while making a decision? I don't know who wants to take that first.
You can go ahead and take a first crack at it. So I'm speaking for myself personally, and I think we talk about this in the BRIS-SMART guidance, especially because this is a tool that is commonly used in data science and engineering. A heat map is a really useful tool for being able to compare multiple risks. So even if they're, whether they're quantitative or qualitative, you know, if they're quantitative, you can have likelihood and consequences on the X and Y axes. If they're qualitative, you can have likelihood and consequences on the X and Y axes, but instead of numbers, you've got low, medium, high. And being able to put those together on a single chart and sort of consider everything together all at once is really helpful. And it also helps, and I kind of alluded to this when I was walking through the framework, it helps you understand, you know, maybe you draw a line where your risk appetite is in terms of consequences and probability. So maybe you really don't like high consequence, low probability events. So you keep those outside the envelope of where you're okay with the decision, and you can sort of factor in multiple different risks all at the same time.
I'll go ahead and add to what Reed just mentioned. The issue of risk appetite is really important there. When we rolled the idea of BRISKSMART to NMSS, we started with discussion about risk appetite and what that looks like when you're weighing multiple risks in a decision. It gets the conversation going, especially for qualitative data, what methodology is going to be deployed to weigh risks and managing those risks. So NMSS benefited from learning how NRR conducts the heat map and allowed us to take an approach to apply qualitative data in a heat map.
Is your ability, did you want to anything?
I guess I can add something real quick. I agree the heat map is very useful for what we're talking about here. Sometimes, personally, when I use the BRISKSMART framework, you get into an area that's kind of in-depth or very technical, and you find out it's just going everywhere. There's so much things to assess. So what I've seen a couple of times is There are certain ways to look at the heat map, you look at the appetite for it, but you might also determine that this is an opportunity to have a different BRISKSMART and ask a different question that could be more broadly applicable to your program. And I think that's helped with ENSER in quite a few cases.
Yeah, and I actually believe that tracking and trending of all of the risk factors, understanding the brackets in which you have risk tolerance, all important to understanding all of the impacts of the different risks. And we try to do that in implementing the BRISKSMART process itself.
So this question's for Reid. Sorry, Reid, it seems like a lot are for you. Can you explain what risk-informed process for evaluations, RIPE, is and how it's been applied to date?
Sure. So RIPE is the risk-informed process for evaluations, as you said. It's a process for evaluating low safety significance issues that are known to be within the plant's licensing basis. And it's currently available to resolve those kinds of issues for plants that are already known to have technically acceptable PRAs, so ones that the NRC has looked at typically through one of the tech spec travelers, and who have also established an integrated decision-making panel, and there's guidance out there for how to do that. And so if a licensee has established a technically acceptable PRA and an IDP, and the licensee can characterize whatever their safety issue is as low safety significance, they can request some kind of licensing activity by the NRC, or that can be reviewed by the NRC using a streamlined process. But currently it's not available to make changes to plant technical specifications, but there's a revision in the works that is working on that we're hoping to roll out later this year. And we got our first application late last year or early this year and accepted it.
Okay. So this question's for the entire panel. What is the difference between BRISKSMART and risk-informed?
I think I could start off on this one. So BRISKSMART is a risk-informed approach, and it kind of lies between risk-based and deterministic approaches. So risk informing ensures that risk insights are considered together with other factors to establish requirements commensurate with their importance to public health and safety. So what we're really saying here is we're looking at risk, but it's being looked at in conjunction with safety margin, defense in depth, performance monitoring, compliance with regulations, stuff like that. And the framework has explicit places where we assess these areas to make the most informed decisions. So I guess the bottom line to the question is BRISKSMART is a risk informed approach.
Did anybody want to add anything? Okay. So the next question, and this is for the entire panel, whoever feels comfortable, what is the risk metrics used when risk informing the NRC decisions and processes? Is it something other than core damage frequency and large early frequency, or is it more qualitative with respect to the risk triplet?
Oh, I can, again, I guess, take a stab at that. Fundamentally, I mean, for reactor safety questions, yeah, the metric is core damage frequency and large early release frequency. But when you have multiple options for decision-making that all are at least good enough, there are other metrics that can come into play. You start talking about reputational risk. You start talking about which might incur the greater legal risks. And those are obviously more qualitative. I hope that answers the question. It's sort of a combination. You might have both quantitative and qualitative risks that you need to bring together. And BRISKSMART is a great way to accomplish that.
Does anybody want to add anything else?
Yeah, I think, Reid, what you were saying was in reference to the heat map you talked about earlier and BRISKSMART facilitating an early discussion about the methodology for identifying the risks and then giving weight to them, which is particularly helpful in a qualitative setting.
Okay, question for Billy and the rest of the panel. Is BRiskSMART used to cut resources?
Not in my experience. In fact, what BRiskSMART has been used for in the regions are to help gain efficiencies and with the current staff that we have. We've experienced some losses due to retirement and retention, and we've used BRiskSMART to deal with those resource issues. But in my experience, to answer the question directly, no, I haven't seen BRiskSMART used to cut staff.
I'd like to weigh into that a little bit. So, from a broader standpoint, we've tried to structure BRiskSMART to be neutral. It doesn't really say you should, use less resources. If it's supposed to tell you that you should be using the amount of effort that's commensurate with the level of risk associated with something, right? So what it should be agnostic to whether something is going to consume more or less resources. And, we do see examples, and I think several of those were highlighted here by the panel earlier today. We see examples where people have used more resources, or at least not the least amount of resources, in resolving something that they evaluated with BRiskSMART. It helps us align the resources that we're using with the needs and can support increasing the resources to areas that are more risk significant. More broadly, also, I think we need to, if we want to make sure that we're not just using it to cut resources, we as an agency, and this is my opinion, need to be using BRiskSMART in more decisions and be more disciplined in applying it, not only in areas where we want to drive efficiencies. We want to be able to say we're focusing the resources where they need to be. And so that means we need to be using risk in more of our decisions.
Does anybody else want to add anything?
Yeah, I was just having a conversation with my office director yesterday about this, and kind of aligns with, are we seeing results from BRiskSMART in our area? And an example similar to what Billy mentioned was the decommissioning reactors oversight program used BRiskSMART when reviewing the program, and it didn't yield a decrease or increase of resources. It simply reprioritized them based on the risk areas associated with the program and allowed the inspectors to, sharpen their focus areas when they go in. So we're seeing a benefit there, and we're seeing BRiskSMART realized with positive results, and not necessarily with an eye towards, changing resources in the process.
So just a reminder, please continue to put in your questions into the chat, and we will try to answer them, put them in the queue. All right, so I have another question. This one's for Billy. Is there alignment between BRiskSMART and the use of probabilistic risk assessment? Would you say that BRiskSMART positively or negatively impacted the NRC's use of PRA?
So I am very confident that the BRiskSMART has not harmed the PRA process. We use insights gained from the PRA process to apply to the BRiskSMART process. So we're using them in conjunction with each other. So PRA is it's a very important vehicle to risk-informed decision-making during the development of the framework. The agency focused on not making it inconsistent with pre-existing processes. And again, I'm talking about the BRiskSMART process. We wanted to make sure that they were not inconsistent with processes like the PRA.
We have another question. Does the risk-informed decision-making process allow to say how safe is safe enough? I don't know who would like to take that.
I can take a stab at it. Fundamentally, the standard that we hold to for safe enough is reasonable assurance of adequate protection. And that's defined through, you know, compliance to the regulations and a bunch of different other things. And going back to the answer that I gave before about, what the risk metrics are, there are, you know, specific risk metrics for core damage frequency and large early release for reactor sites, but those don't really apply across the board. I wouldn't say that RITM itself defines how safe is safe enough. There are lots of different factors that play into that. I don't know if anybody else wants to add to that.
Hey, I agree with what you said. And I just wanted to add, it really is the risk appetite and the specific question that you're asking. So sometimes you may be willing to be a little more risky in an area, maybe if there's a little less defense in depth, because as we said, this is a risk-informed process, right? So we're looking at risk and we're also looking at other deterministic factors. That's all going to play into the decision you're going to make, and we look at both.
So we have another question, and I think Mirabelle, this might be one for you, but other panel members are certainly welcome to add to it. How does BRISC-SMART fit into the vision of NRC being a modern risk-informed regulator? What does that really mean?
Sure. So I think BRISC-SMART, in terms of a timeline, was really born out of the idea or that, you know, buzz term of modern risk-informed regulator. I remember shortly after hearing management talk about modern risk informed regulator, there was that push to create a framework where we could apply a risk informed approach to decision making. So really, it's chicken egg sort of the question. Where BRISC-SMART fits in is it enables us to answer those questions about, you know, this, where we now live in a digital era where we didn't foresee sharing information through certain mediums or receiving it a certain way. We didn't have insights about what the nuclear landscape looked like 20 years ago when regulations were written. And we, you know, advanced reactors or accident tolerant fuel, these are developments that are, you know, we're living through them, and we need ways to assess them for licensing. And BRISC-SMART allows us to do that because it allows new information to be considered alongside the traditional risks that we've assessed and make a risk-informed decision to ensure that we're meeting our mission.
Does anybody want to add anything? Okay. So we do have another question, and this is a really important question. How will the NRC know that its transformation efforts on the use of risk and decision-making is reaching all levels of staff? I know that many of you have served as ambassadors for the BRISC-SMART and also part of the core team. And, you know, we've gotten, you know, some survey results, and you know, the vision, the ultimate vision, the, you know, ideal state would be having everybody across NRC factoring in risk information in a common way across the enterprise so that we could have meaningful discussions around risk and make the best decisions and the most timely decisions. So what would you say on that?
So, were you about to go, Stacy?
I will go after you. I'm sure yours will be a great answer, and I'll just come to you.
Well, I was just going to say, you know, take a look at the cross-section of the staff that we've got here today. We've got people from all different offices. We've got, you know, line supervisors, staff, senior manager, all represented here. I think it is happening. We are reaching everybody at the NRC and across the business lines and extending to, you know, not the technical areas as well, you know, into the corporate and legal areas too. So I think we're doing a great job of that. And yeah, so Stacy.
I was just gonna add, so people are resistant to change when anything new comes out. And I remember when this first got rolled out, people are like, oh, another risk-informed initiative. And it was kind of like that cooler talk. No one wanted to actually use the framework. That's how it started. That's how a lot of things start when people are seeing something new. Now, when I go to meetings or we have teams where we can chat privately with other employees, so more often than not, people are even bringing up in those discussions, oh, I use the framework for this. What do you think of this heat map? And it's becoming part of a normal conversation when a big decision is made. Management is, I'm an NSER, so I'm under Morella, and she's a big support of the riskSMART framework. So we use it all the time in management in NSER, but all levels down, I can't think of a meeting that I've been to, at least in the past couple months, where the riskSMART framework wasn't utilized.
And I'll tell you from my perspective, many of the examples that I studied and even presented today were born out of the suggestions for staff and during the application of riskSMART and their presentation to myself and to management. So it makes me believe that the staff has embraced the process and they're using it for their benefit. You know, just last week I listened to a discussion on riskSMART from the inspectors in the health physics branch to talk about the Part 37 and documentation of Part 37. And it really exemplified the staff's use and acceptance of the riskSMART process. So yes, I've seen it and I think it's taken hold at all levels of the staff.
So Ben, I'll round out with the cynical voice that hopefully has a little positive ending at the end of it. As you mentioned in my bio, I came to the working group with some skepticism about application of riskSMART, specifically to my working area. And that's something I had really heard throughout NMSS. Without the use of a PRA, how are we going to deploy this framework? For corporate, for technical, for legal decisions, how do you consider risk in these different disciplines? So that was a challenge for me coming into it. And I think it's through that practiced approach of riskSMART and teaching and talking to other staff that it's sort of become second nature for me. At the same time, I think there's still a lot that can be done, especially by the working group, to continue to reach staff at all levels. I'll get a little bit into the weeds on what we do in NMSS and hopefully it sparks some feedback that we can consider. But in our office, we have a working group that is constantly talking to staff and collecting examples of riskSMART wins. And we really are emphasizing the teaching element of riskSMART. So we're making sure it gets into Nuclepedia, which is a resource for teaching examples and lessons learned on various high profile topics. We created a SharePoint where we have been hosting pop-up seminars where staff talk about their use of riskSMART in a scenario. We save the recordings and put them available on our SharePoint so staff can go and watch them and hopefully identify with the area that's being covered. We've covered corporate examples, things about contract renewal. We've talked about engagement with stakeholders. We've talked about safety analysis. We're trying to cover all areas because especially in NMSS where there are multiple business lines and multiple disciplines, we want to make sure that we're reaching all those levels. So that's a work in progress right now for us.
Reed, did you want to add something?
Yeah, so, when I joined the agency, however many years ago it was, my background is in deterministic safety analysis work. And, I wanted to kind of echo what Mirabel said, though my cynicism and reluctance, I would say, predates even the advent of riskSMART. And, when I joined the agency, I was sort of like, oh, well, PRA is a risk is a thing for those PRA people to do. And I don't need to worry about it. I'll just focus on my deterministic safety analysis. And I think that working with those people who are in NRR Division of Risk Assessment and sort of opening my mind to the possibilities of what you could consider with risk and understanding how it's used in the inspection program and elsewhere in the agency really helped me see its value and utility in making decisions. And I think that a lot of people are starting to come around, even in the staunchest parts of the agency where people would have that opinion of, well, that's something for somebody else to worry about. They are coming around to that because they're actually seeing it make a difference.
So I'll just add that from a corporate perspective, we have enterprise risk management, which is part of our internal controls and strategic plan and performance management system. And the senior leaders quarterly talk about enterprise risks. So, you know, we don't just want senior management driving risk discussion. We want to have risk discussion happen everywhere within the agency so that, you know, people who are best positioned to identify a risk are managing that risk and then engaging with the senior leadership as appropriate. But, you know, I mean, I can reflect on some of those discussions, and I mean, we've managed so many risks, I can't even, mention how many, but I mean, we have a whole very systematic process where quarterly we look at what are the major risks before the agency. And I think, you know, anybody who's been sitting listening to the commissioners and the EDO and the chairman has heard over and over this hiring risk, because I think when you looked back and saw the data, we hadn't been hiring enough externally. We've been moving people more internally, and that's why we're shifting that focus in FY this fiscal year 2022, where we're really trying to shift the agency's focus on bringing in more people externally while still allowing people to grow. We definitely want our internal staff to have opportunities to get promoted as well. So that's just something that is an example of an enterprise risk. And a lot of that was driven by some corporate concerns. And now it's become like an agency focus. So it's actually really exciting to see. We actually put together a steering group and a corporate work group to really focus on it. And once we put the work group together, we identified that there were multiple risks. There's the onboarding risk. I mean, we can't just hire people, we have to onboard them well. and so we really want to retain people, we want to onboard them. I mean, we just want the whole process to be addressed. So anyway, a lot of that was born out of the thinking about risks. So Reid, a question for you. Can you talk more specifically about the mission analytics portal? How is it helping to improve decisions?
I'm happy to tackle that. I'm not sure it's a BRiskSMART question, but it's a
spot piece. So if you could connect
to BRiskSMART. Right, I will. Use of data in decision making, and that's definitely part of it. So, I think that one of the big things that MAP is doing, at least in NRR, is helping make information just readily accessible to make decisions. So we used to have a meeting where we would go through all of the projects that we're working on and talk about, you know, which ones might be at risk of blowing through metrics and whether those needed more management attention on them to make sure that they were getting done and we were going to meet the metrics. That meeting has gotten streamlined and condensed thanks to the use of dashboards and data to where like it basically doesn't even need to happen anymore. So that's a risk that we're managing, or we're managing risks on each one of those individual projects by being able to see exactly where things are in the process at any given point in time. So that's one example. I'm sure there are others in other business lines. I know that we recently just implemented a change or a new set of dashboards to help facilitate the end of cycle meetings in the regions for their inspection cycle. And I think they're starting to make a difference there.
Thank you. So, the next question is for the entire panel. Do you have any indication how many people are using this framework?
So I'll start off with, in terms of data and a specific number, I couldn't ballpark that for you. But what I can say is that for NMSS to get an idea, we have one of our objectives and key results being use of the BRiskSMART framework. And in with that respect, we wanted to, you know, encourage staff to use BRiskSMART in their decision making and document it so that there is that opportunity to teach down the line, but also the ability to track that metric. And how we're helping staff is identifying the types of meetings where they can expect that BRiskSMART will be asked and give them some tips for preparing for it. So when we're talking about external stakeholder engagement, you can expect BRiskSMART will be inquired by the upper levels of management. So we have staff thinking about that at an earlier point in time. When we're talking about assignment and alignment meetings, that's a great opportunity to use BRISC-SMART to ensure that we're aligning on the risk significant issues that are under consideration. So I don't have an exact number, but what I can say is that it's being promoted within NMSS, which areas absolutely should be considering BRISC-SMART and capturing documentation of that in our repository so that we can continue to teach. I will say that right now, our objective and key result is set around, we wanna see about 75% of decision-making, not only is using BRISC-SMART, but it's also focusing on that data element, kind of what Reed was alluding to, and looking at more ways to incorporate the data aspect into the decision-making and capture it. So that's something we're working towards.
If I can add on to a little bit what Mirabel was just saying. So we also in NRR have an OKR related to use of BRISC-SMART in decisions. But I would also say that, you know, not all decisions that people might use concepts from BRISC-SMART are ones that we would track or get a sense of. If people are, you know, talking about very low level things, decisions in their own everyday work that that they're trying to decide, they wouldn't document that and pass it along to somebody else or put it into a dashboard someplace. And I think that that's the kind of groundswell of interest in risk-informed decision-making that we're seeing is kind of at that level. So I think it's hard to objectively measure exactly who's using BRISC-SMART in what senses. I mean, definitely what Mirabel was talking about, we are doing that at the office level, but there are lots of lower level decisions that happen all the time that are a lot harder to track. And hopefully we're making an impact there.
I think Reed, you just reminded me, we've had conversations with staff, we find out they are using BRISC-SMART. They just didn't know that that's the name of it. So part of our effort to engage with staff on BRISC-SMART is to help them realize that they're already using this umbrella framework and it could be applied at day-to-day, everyday activities and just making it feel more organic and part of our regular toolbox.
All right, so here's a good question. How do we make sure that BRISC-SMART does not become just another fad? I think Stacy, you wanted to weigh in first and maybe others want to add after that.
Yeah, I can start off with this. So the group that put together this framework did a commendable job setting up a solid framework that really has all the elements that you need to succeed. That being said, could it still be a fad? Maybe. But to keep the framework relevant, we purposely added that little arrow at the end of the process that allows you to reassess. So we need to ensure we are using that process to reassess as needed so we're keeping the pace with regulatory environment transformation. I mean, it's all part of the transformation process. We have it filled in. So far it's looking good and we're hoping it continues down that path, but only time will tell.
Yeah, I'll add to what Stacy said. When I was talking to my office director about this the other day, he made a good point that, you know, BRISC-SMART is at a certain level of maturity where we're going to start seeing the benefits of some actions as we go through that realize step now. So I don't think it's going to be a fad in a sense of disappearing, you know, in a year or two, because there are projects that are underway that still need to go through the realize element to understand, you know, where we need to correct course and, you know, go through the iterative process, like Stacy said. There are ways that we are ensuring we're ingraining the framework into current guidance. For example, I mentioned the inspection manual chapters that are under review. In many cases, the text of those documents are incorporating BRISC-SMART language and terminology just to help make sure that we're ingraining it in the guidance that staff can put their hands on.
So the one thing that I would just mention is this is very correlated with enterprise risk management. The whole vision of enterprise risk management is really to engage staff. So I see them all very connected. you know, it's just going through a systematic methodology where you're really thinking about these things and it's common sense and it's giving us some language where corporate people like myself can talk to technical people like you, as well as legal people. And I've also, you know, found myself pushing back on legal sometimes when they just say, here's one option. I'm like, well, that can't be the only option. I mean, we need to generate other options. We need to look at the risks associated with each option. We need to look at the benefits, and we also need to look at what problem we're trying to solve. So I'm like constantly saying these things over and over and over. And I remember Mike Weber, I don't know if you guys remember Mike Weber, but he used to say, when you're exhausted of communicating, that's when you're finally reaching people. So I don't see this as a fad because it's just common sense, you know, and I think that it's adding value. And I think that that's what will make it thrive and live. And anyway, I wanted to add that.
I wanted to chime in with one more thing. And I think this kind of goes back to what Mirabelle and I said on the last question. I think where we get to not fad status is people are using it. They're comfortable with it. It becomes part of their regular everyday work. And then it's not a fad because it's just something that you do. And it doesn't go away because it's just part of the organizational culture. And it's something that, you know, you learn when you come to the NRC is this is something that you do. That's where I think real success is and you know, not being a fad. And I would say we've done, like I mentioned in my talk, we did some polling internally to talk about who's driving risk-informed decision-making. And right now we think it's equal. You know, we want to see that continue over time to be sure that we're being successful.
So I'll just give you an opportunity for any final thoughts before I turn to closing remarks. We're almost out of time. Billy, did you want to make a closing statement of any kind?
No, as I stated, I'll just mention, as I stated during the presentation, and we've talked about this, throughout this question and answer session. I believe that the staff is intimately engaged in the BRISMART process. You know, as I manage daily, I constantly have staff presenting issues to me, and they're presenting them in the BRISMART framework. So I think from that perspective, it's been a real success. I've seen decisions that have created effectiveness and efficiency that I think have been invaluable over the last 2 years or so. So again, I believe that the BRISMART process is a process that should be incorporated at all levels of the agency and ways found to incorporate it in all of our decision-making processes. So that's it.
Anyone else would like to make a final statement? Okay, well, you guys are just an amazing panel. That's pretty much all the time that we have. This has been a wonderful discussion. And I would like to call up this email on this slide. You can send any remaining comments or questions that you have that did not get answered for you. And we can ensure follow-up. I want to thank the panel members for their wonderful presentations. I also want to thank Katie McCurry, Elizabeth Bolin, and Morella Gavrilis, and other BRISKSMART team members for the critical roles that they played in making this panel a success. I also want to thank the audience for your engagement and your fantastic questions. And I do want to remind you about the stakeholder survey on transformation. Please take that if you haven't already. That concludes our BRISKSMART panel, and thank you for attending.